Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Forced Founders, Indians, Debtors, Slaves, and the Making of the American Revolution in Virginia, by Woody Holton, narrated by Cassandra Campbell. Introduction. Americans tend to think of the Virginia gentry, the colonial elite that gave us Thomas Jefferson and George Washington, as a proud and optimistic ruling class. They do not imagine gentlemen resorting to desperate measures, such as crashing down the gates of prisons or placing weapons in the hands of slaves. But in April 1774, Jacob Haight, one of the wealthiest men in Berkeley County, Virginia, did both of those things and more. The desperation experienced by men like Haight, and to a surprising extent by men like Jefferson and Washington as well, helped drive them into the American Revolution. Since they took Britain's largest American colony with them, anyone interested in the origins of the independence movement needs to understand why they felt so desperate. Haight was the son of a highly successful Shenandoah Valley land speculator, and had hoped to replicate his father's success farther west. In the late 1760s, he and his business partner, Richard Paris, contrived a way to obtain a large tract of land from the Cherokee Indians. Paris had a son, George, by a Cherokee woman. Métis like George Paris were viewed by Cherokee headmen as useful diplomatic bridges to British America, whose interests should be promoted. So when George asked headmen for a 150,000-acre tract just west of South Carolina, they gave it to him. George Paris then sold the land to his father and Jacob Haight. It was a clever scheme, but a British official feared that it might provoke the Cherokees to join an anti-British confederation that Indian diplomats were just then assembling. He persuaded a South Carolina court to void the deal. The revocation of the Cherokee deed left Jacob Haight with no way to pay a 1,600-pound debt to James Hunter, a Scottish trader in Fredericksburg. Hunter, who was feeling pressure from his own creditors in England, sued, won, and in 1773 demanded that the Berkeley County Sheriff Adam Stephen auction off enough of Haight's property to pay the debt. For Haight, Hunter's demand could not have come at a worse time. By the fall of 1773, the price of tobacco had sunk to one of its lowest levels ever. Even in the Shenandoah Valley, where Jacob Haight lived and where little tobacco was grown, the credit market collapsed, and the price of most everything farmers produced and owned plummeted. During that period of cash scarcity and deflation, the liquidation of Haight's debt to Hunter would require the sale of a large portion of his property. He would be ruined. Haight managed to fend off Sheriff Stephen for a year, but on April 12, 1774, the sheriff seized 15 of Haight's slaves and 21 of his horses and took them to Martinsburg, the county seat. He locked the slaves in the county jail and the horses in the jailer's stable, and then he announced an auction. Haight had to think fast. On Thursday morning, April 14th, his son Thomas and a gang of men armed with guns, swords, pistols, and axes advanced on Martinsburg. Sheriff Stephen deputized several men and directed them to guard Jacob Haight's slaves and horses, but Thomas Haight's gang surrounded the jail, overpowered the guards, broke down the doors of the jail and the stable, and seized the slaves and horses. The gang also freed Merle Handley, a smallholder that had been imprisoned for debt, and another person that had been jailed on suspicion of being a runaway servant. The group captured two of the prison guards, tied them up, and confined them, along with the slaves, at Jacob Haight's house. Later that day, Haight got word that Sheriff Stephen's posse was about to attack. If the sheriff achieved his purpose of selling Haight's horses and slaves, the worst victims would be the slaves themselves, since their families would probably be divided forever. Recognizing that he and his slaves had a common interest in preventing their sale and desperately needing more fighters, Hite went into the kitchen where his Negroes were and told them to follow up the white men and upon the first gun that was fired to rush in with what weapons they had and to do what they could, but to take care not to hurt their own men, one of Hite's white supporters later reported. Hite's slaves never got the chance to test their mettle against the sheriff's posse, since its attack was delayed long enough for Hite to start them south down the Great Wagon Road toward his illegal settlement in Cherokee country. Along the road, at least some of Hite's enslaved workers were captured, and later they were sold at auction. The conflict did not end there. Hite sued the men in Sheriff Stevens' posse, and the deputies feared that the jury would side with Hite. It being too general a wish among the people to evade the payment of their debts and render the authority of court judgments of none effect. The widespread wish to prevent the enforcement of court judgments against Virginia debtors became a troubling subject of conversation in Williamsburg, the provincial capital, but as it turned out, the wish was soon to be granted. In June 1774, less than 2 months after Hite's gang broke open the Berkeley County Jail, Virginia courts began to refuse to try suits brought by creditors against debtors. The courts closed partly to protest Parliament's assault on American liberty, and partly to prevent creditors from depriving debtors such as Hite and Handley of their property and freedom. The Hite gang's assault on the Berkeley County Jail raises questions about the elite Virginians that led Britain's largest North American colony into the Revolution. Jacob Hite clearly was a desperate man. Did a similar sense of desperation overcome other gentlemen on the eve of the Revolution? Our tendency is to answer no. Men like George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, and Patrick Henry live in the American memory as the proud exemplars of a supremely confident gentry class. Historians have long assumed it was that very confidence that emboldened Virginia gentlemen to lead their colony and 12 of her sisters out of the British Empire. The gentry's self-assurance, we are told, rested on a firm foundation. Gentlemen such as Washington and Jefferson exercised almost unchallenged hegemony over other classes in the province. They had established authority over the poorest 40% of Virginians by enslaving them. Native Americans might slow, but they could not halt the colony's westward advance. Even the gentry's relationship with British merchants, about which Jefferson and others frequently complained, has been presented in modern scholarship as more beneficial to gentlemen than they were willing to admit. Their British friends, for such they called them in their correspondence, marketed their tobacco, filled their invoices by making the rounds of the London tradesmen, and even loaned them money. From that viewpoint, the key to the Virginia gentlemen's secure position at the top of the social pyramid was their remarkably cordial relationship with small farmers. Elsewhere in 18th century America, in the Hudson Valley with its vast landed estates, in both Carolinas and especially in the great northern seaports, elites often seemed besieged by farmers, tenants, artisans, and sailors. But the Virginia gentleman that consorted with his lower class neighbors was greeted with deference, historians tell us. The gentry and smallholder classes were unified by their mutual interest in growing tobacco and in controlling slaves and women. Altogether, with the help of his junior partners among the yeomanry, the Virginia gentleman seems to have controlled the movements of Indians, merchants, slaves, and smallholders almost as if they were puppets. Little wonder, then, that the gentleman felt secure enough to take the Old Dominion into the American Revolution. Starting in the 1960s, those two notions, that the gentry was brimming with confidence and that it was in complete control of its relations with Indians, smallholders, slaves, and even British merchants, were challenged. Some historians found that the gentry's confidence was laced with anxiety. Others have shown that although the old image of gentlemen exerting enormous influence over those groups was not false, None of them was the gentry's puppet. In fact, each had its own ability to pull strings. One arena in which they powerfully influenced gentlemen was imperial politics. In complex ways, and without intending to, Indians, merchants, and slaves helped drive gentlemen like Jacob Haidt and smallholders like Merty Handley into the rebellion against Britain. In addition, small farmers exerted direct and deliberate pro-independence pressure upon gentlemen. That particular web of influences helping to push Virginia into the War of Independence is the subject of this work. From 1763 to 1776, Indians, merchants, slaves, and debtors helped propel free Virginians into the independence movement in three distinct ways. First, the free Virginians' efforts to influence imperial policy were contested by Native Americans, British merchants, and enslaved Virginians. The elimination of the government as an instrument or ally of merchants, Indians, and slaves was one reason for white Virginians to rebel against Britain. Second, free Virginians were attracted to the most important resistance strategy of the pre-war period, the commercial boycott against Britain. Because it seemed likely not only to impel Parliament to repeal laws considered oppressive by white Americans, but also to reduce the Virginians' debt to British merchants. Third, the thoroughgoing boycott adopted by the First Continental Congress in October 1774 transformed Virginia's society and economy in unexpected ways. It presented opportunities to enslaved Virginians and put extraordinary pressure upon the colony's small farmers. In responding to those opportunities and pressures, slaves and farmers challenged the authority of the provincial gentry. Those challenges indirectly help induce gentlemen to turn the protests of 1774 into the independence movement of 1776. Who were the members of the pre-revolutionary gentry? And how was the gentry related to other groups within and beyond Virginia? The two questions call forth the same answer. Since it was the gentry's relations with Indians, British merchants, slaves, and smallholders that defined it as a class. Satirist James Reed declared in the 1760s that a Virginian qualified as a gentleman as soon as he acquired money, Negroes, and land enough. Other definitions of the gentry would isolate essentially the same people. Gentlemen sat in the House of Burgesses, on the Executive Council, and on the benches of the county courts. Although nearly half of white Virginians owned one or two field slaves, almost all of the domestic slaves, along with most of the brick houses, imported luxuries like books, and the most fertile tidewater lands were owned by members of the gentry. Gentlemen and gentlewomen were the wealthiest 10% of free Virginians. They owned one half of Virginia's property. Most Virginia tobacco growers sold their crops in the colony, but gentlemen consigned theirs to British merchants. Although all of those definitions of the gentry are useful, none is as precise as James Reed's. He knew that what set elite Virginians apart was not simply the amount of property they owned, but also the type. Reed's money, Negroes, and land were essentially the factors of production, capital, labor, and land. Gentlemen struggled for control of each factor against other groups, against British merchants over capital, against agricultural workers, both enslaved and free, over the fruits of their labor, and against Indians over their land. Just as the gentry was defined as a class by its relations with Indians, merchants, and free and enslaved laboring class Virginians, those other groups may be defined in relation to the gentry. Gentry-Indian relations underwent a major transformation after 1750, when free Virginians began to covet the land west of the Appalachian Mountains. That was the fruitful hunting territory of the Upper Ohio nations, principally the Mingos, Shawnees, and Delawares. The Upper Ohioans' most fertile territory beyond the mountains, Kentucky, was also the hunting land of the Cherokees. Although Cherokees and Upper Ohioans disagreed about who owned Kentucky, they agreed that Britain did not. When Virginia land speculators began staking claims to Kentucky, they courted conflicts with settlers, Indians, and British bureaucrats. Another group that came into conflict with the gentry, and with smallholders as well, comprised the tobacco merchants of England and Scotland. By the time of the American Revolution, tobacco growers, large and small, owed huge debts to the British merchants. During the preceding century, Virginia's per capita debt had nearly doubled. Growers blamed their debts partly on the Navigation Acts, which gave British merchants a monopoly of their trade. Although by the 1760s, free Virginians had submitted to the Navigation Acts for more than a century, they deeply resented them, and they resolutely refused to endure any additional burden. When the British government tried to impose just such a new burden, taxes, the Americans were irate. The conflict between Virginia debtors and British merchant creditors aggravated the imperial struggle in another way as well. It was partly to reduce their debts to British merchants that free Virginians participated in the patriotic non-importation and non-exportation associations. The 18th century tobacco trade was complex, and in order to be clear at all times about what type of merchant I am referring to, I make some distinctions between the word merchants and its synonyms that 18th century Virginians would not have recognized. The mercantile firms and transatlantic slave traders in Glasgow, London, and other British ports will be called merchants. The employees of those merchants that were located in the Chesapeake will be denoted storekeepers or factors. Such employees may be distinguished from a third group, independent Virginia entrepreneurs, who shall be designated traders. Another relationship that changed radically in the 18th century was that between slave owners and the people they owned. The enslaved portion of Virginia's population grew from less than 9% at the turn of the century to 40% in 1775, by which time an estimated 186,000 Virginians were black. Natural increase, which had begun by 1730, was good news for slave owners, not only financially, but also because it allowed the House of Burgesses to exclude the workers that were considered most dangerous, newly enslaved Africans, from the province. But if Afro-Virginia demography worked in the slaveholders' favor, British politics did not. When the House of Burgesses tried to impose prohibitive duties on every African brought to Virginia, British merchants persuaded the Privy Council, Britain's executive body, to veto the duties. Where, in other cases, the power that merchants wielded over the London government hurt gentry Virginians financially, here, in combination with the threat that slaves posed, it also endangered their lives. The lure of political independence grew as a consequence. Starting in late 1774, enslaved Virginians did even more to hasten the growth of patriotic sentiment. By drawing the last royal governor into an alliance with them, freedom-seeking Afro-Virginians helped estrange white Virginians from the royal government and prepare them for independence. So far, this summary of political and social relations in pre-revolutionary Virginia has focused on gentlemen and taken note of areas, such as the conflict against enslaved Virginians, where the interests of the gentry converged with those of smallholders. Actually, one of the most important relationships in the colony was that between gentlemen and smallholders. Among an estimated 280,000 white Virginians in 1775, no more than 10% were gentlemen. Perhaps another 10% were artisans, traders, and overseers of slaves. That leaves well over 200,000 people in the yeomanry. Small farmers came under tremendous pressure in 1775 when the non-exportation provisions of the Continental Association deprived them of their export income and non-importation subjected them to severe shortages. Those pressures drew forth an agrarian response that, in complex ways, attributed to the gentry's decision to make a formal declaration of independence. Here, another descriptive distinction needs to be made. 18th century Virginians sometimes applied the term planters to small-scale tobacco growers. At other times, it meant everyone that grew tobacco, including gentlemen. By the middle of the 19th century, census takers would introduce yet another definition of planters. They were people that owned 20 or more slaves. In order to avoid all that confusion, this book eschews the term planters altogether. Instead, gentlemen will be distinguished from small farmers, also smallholders. On many of the issues discussed here, the interests of smallholders were similar to those of long-term tenants, so for brevity's sake, smallholders must be stretched to include both groups. On occasions when the interest of tobacco-growing smallholders and gentlemen converged, I will refer to the two groups together as tobacco growers. Since this work argues that non-elites powerfully influenced revolutionary politics, the listener may well ask how it is possible to know very much about those people when the majority of them could not write and the few that could left few records. I did not find using gentry sources to study non-gentlemen as difficult as I had feared, for it quickly became obvious that gentlemen were very interested in the actions of Indians, slaves, and smallholders, as well as British merchants, who left plenty of records of their own. To cite only one example, even in July 1776, Landon Carter showed less interest in imperial affairs than in recovering a group of slaves that had escaped his custody. To be sure, non-elites often deceived elites, and elites' biases often distorted their reporting. But if used with care, top-down sources can in fact be effectively used for bottom-up history. It seems wise to underscore at the outset that this book is rather narrowly focused, although I suspect that elite patriots and other colonies were influenced by non-elites just as much as Virginia gentlemen were. This work is only about the Old Dominion. It is not a comprehensive social history of pre-revolutionary Virginia, but a study of some, not all, of the causes, not the effects, of Virginia's revolution. The story told here reveals that when Virginia gentlemen launched their struggle to preserve and extend their freedom, they were powerfully influenced by other freedom struggles, movements put together by Indians, debtors, merchants, slaves, and smallholders. Part 1. Grievances, 1763 to 1774. He has endeavored to prevent the population of these states, for that purpose raising the conditions of new appropriations of lands. Declaration of Independence. 1. Land Speculators versus Indians and the Privy Council. During the winter of 1768 to 1769, Thomas Jefferson set about obtaining government patents for 7,000 acres of land to the west of the Appalachian Mountains. Jefferson actually had no plans to move west. About the time of his birth in 1743, however, a wave of westward expansion had breached the Blue Ridge Mountains of Virginia and joined another wave sweeping south along the Shenandoah Valley from Pennsylvania. By 1769, frontier families were already moving west of the Appalachians. Jefferson knew that as soon as he could obtain his land patents and divide them into farmsteads of about 200 acres each, he would find numerous customers for them. Jefferson's hunger for Western wealth was shared by other Virginia gentlemen. George Washington recognized that the greatest estates we have in this colony were made by taking up and purchasing at very low rates the rich backlands, which were thought nothing of in those days, but are now the most valuable lands we possess. Washington gazed with equal parts envy and admiration toward the Shenandoah Valley, where the Heights and other first takers up of those lands had made fortunes. The ability of gentlemen such as Jefferson and Washington to profit from the sale of Western land depended not only upon their entrepreneurial skills, but also upon their political influence. In October 1768, shortly before Jefferson began applying for his Western grants, the Cherokee Indians negotiated a treaty with the British government, in which they retained every acre that Jefferson claimed. The agreement, known as the Treaty of Hard Labor, also interfered with Washington's land speculation, so it was evidently with some enthusiasm that the owners of Mount Vernon and Monticello joined every other member of the Virginia House of Burgesses in asking the imperial government to revoke it. The Burgesses' petition, adopted in December 1769, asked London's permission for Virginia to annex Kentucky and all of the land north to the mouth of the Kanawha River. The government's response to the Burgesses' petition would powerfully influence the financial standings of gentlemen like Jefferson and Washington. Ultimately, it would also affect their allegiance to Britain. The fate of the House of Burgesses' petition rested with British officials, whose visions of the West incorporated the Indians that lived there. In the 1760s, Kentucky was the principal hunting ground, both for the Cherokees, about 7,200 people, and for the Upper Ohio Valley nations, the Mingos, 600, Shawnees, 1,800, and Delawares, 3,500. As one Cherokee put it in 1775, Indians looked upon their cattle or game in Kentucky to be as beneficial to them as the tame cattle were to the white people. Peltry was vital to these nations not only in itself but also as a cash crop, for they imported a higher percentage of their clothing and tools than many backcountry whites. Indeed, long before Europeans arrived in North America, hunters there had known that they could rise in status by achieving success as traders. After America's commercial network was linked to Europe's, successful trading became increasingly important to Indian men's identity. One Cherokee, Old Hop, told a visiting European that a fresh supply of red cloth would enable him to appear like a man. The reason that the Indians' desire to preserve their Kentucky hunting territory attracted the attention of imperial officials in London was not that officials felt any moral obligation to the Indians, nor even that they were determined to maintain the flow of deerskins into British ports. What did worry statesmen in the mother country was the likelihood that if Virginians occupied Kentucky, Indians would attack them, and the British army might have to come to the rescue at great cost to the imperial treasury. The danger was not imaginary. Upon learning of the Burgesses' bid for Kentucky, the British agent that had negotiated the hard labor treaty recalled that a 1763 Indian attack, inappropriately termed Pontiac's Rebellion, had proved expensive and destructive to His Majesty's subjects and to his government. Because the government was so determined to prevent another uprising, the natives' effort to preserve their Kentucky hunting territory helped to produce an imperial land policy that protected their interests but at the same time poisoned the relationship between Virginia gentlemen and the government of Britain. 1. 6.5 years before the House of Burgesses drew up its petition for Kentucky, Indians had signaled their determination to defend their land. As Virginian Peter Fontaine reported in August 1763, warriors of the Upper Ohio Valley, Wabash River, and Great Lakes nations entered into a combination against us, resolved, it seems, to prevent our settling any farther than we have, viz. Much about the main Blue Ridge of Mountains. Thus, participants in Pontiac's Rebellion raided 12 British forts and numerous settlements as far east as Winchester, Virginia. At the time of the uprising, royal officials in London were already studying a proposal to confine Britain's North American colonies behind a western boundary. They had two principal goals. One was to keep the colonists within Britain's economic and political orbit, the other to halt colonial encroachments on Indian land in order to prevent a costly Anglo-Indian war. The boundary idea came too late to prevent the uprising, but carried the day when news of Pontiac's rebellion reached London. On October 7th, 1763, British officials drew a line along the watershed between rivers flowing east into the Atlantic and those flowing west into the Mississippi. American governors were prohibited from issuing any land grants beyond this line. Most historians deny that the so-called Proclamation of 1763 was a cause of the American Revolution. They ask how the proclamation could have angered colonists when it was only a paper blockade that failed to prevent settlers from simply crossing the Appalachian Mountains and establishing farms. Indeed, as a Virginia Gazette essayist pointed out in 1773, not even a second Chinese wall, unless guarded by a million of soldiers, could prevent the settlement of the lands on Ohio and its dependencies. The ease with which yeoman families slipped across the imaginary proclamation line has led scholars, particularly pro-Indian historians, to assume that the barrier was also ineffective against speculators. That assumption is wrong. Speculators must be distinguished from settlers as a separate class with very different interests. Speculators could not sell land until they secured clear title to it. Starting back in 1745, the gentry-dominated Executive Council of Virginia gave gentry-owned land companies preliminary grants to millions of acres west of the Appalachian Mountains. Then the land firm's effort to acquire and sell this land was interrupted, first by the start of the Seven Years' War in 1754, and then by the 1758 Treaty of Easton, which reserved the area west of the Appalachian Mountains for the Indians. During this time, the Virginia land firm's preliminary grants expired, which prevented most of them from securing title to the land they claimed. The companies were barred from renewing their preliminary grants by the Proclamation of 1763. Many years later, a lawyer for two land firms pronounced the proclamation a species of tyranny that was sufficient to prevent the operations of the companies. The Proclamation of 1763 infuriated Virginia land speculators. "I shall call upon you sometime next week and condole with you in your late misfortune," Virginian David Robinson wrote fellow speculator William Thompson when he learned of the new boundary. "Colonel Buchanan is going to London to redress his grievances." Robinson found widespread opposition to the British government's policy of giving the Indians land, their land, for peace. "Captain Sayers has been damning this month about the loss of the drunkard's bottom and is not yet reconciled," he told Thompson. "'Tis a great mercy that Roanoke River has not in like manner been given as a compliment to our good friends and faithful allies, the Shawnee Indians." Anglican minister Jonathan Boucher reported that a friend had planned to settle west of the Appalachian Mountains, but this is put a stop to by a very impolitic as well as unjust proclamation forbidding any of the king's subjects to settle lands so far back. Arthur Lee spent much of the 1760s searching Westminster for a British official willing to approve a 2,500,000-acre trans-Appalachian grant to the Mississippi Land Company, which he had formed along with four of his brothers and 38 other Virginia gentlemen. Lee's lobbying proved unsuccessful, and by 1768 he had decided that the present ministry is truly anti-American and very averse to making grants except in small portions. One of Lee's Mississippi Company partners, George Washington, was more optimistic. In 1767, he assured a friend that the Proclamation of 1763 would prove to be nothing more than a temporary expedient to quiet the minds of the Indians. Scarcely a year later, however, Cherokee headman and British Indian agent John Stuart negotiated the Treaty of Hard Labor, leaving the region that is now Kentucky, Southwest Virginia, and Southern West Virginia in Cherokee country. The Hard Labor Treaty was no more popular among Virginia land speculators than the Proclamation of 1763. Both intendant and Indians are on a wrong scent, at least one very different from what we intend. Thomas Lewis, the chief government surveyor for Augusta County on the Virginia frontier, told his deputy and fellow land jobber William Preston in January 1769. The hard labor treaty did not drive Virginia land speculators to despair and resignation. In fact, one of them, Patrick Henry, chose this very time to invest in the disputed area. Henry bought 3,334 acres of land on the Holston and Clinch Rivers from his insolvent father-in-law. He recalled later that the boundary the Cherokee headman had negotiated with Stuart would have cut off the said lands on Holston and Clinch, and under that risk I purchased it, hoping that line would be altered. Many Virginia land speculators did more than hope. They launched a campaign to persuade the Privy Council to let them have Kentucky and the area north to the forks of the Ohio. The speculators had some powerful allies. Northern Indian agent William Johnson and Johnson's own allies and adoptive kinsmen, the headmen of the Six Nations of the Iroquois. Less than a month after John Stuart and the Cherokees negotiated the hard labor treaty, the Iroquois met Johnson at Fort Stanwix, New York, and sold the same area to Virginia. The Iroquois almost never hunted in Kentucky. Thus, their claim to it, which was based upon their status as the diplomatic elder brethren of some of the nations that did hunt there, was not very sound. Iroquois leaders nonetheless insisted, at the covert request of Johnson, one suspects, that Britain accept the vast territory described in the Treaty of Fort Stanwix. Since the Iroquois Confederacy had long been the British Empire's most important Indian ally, Johnson and the Virginia land speculators felt confident that imperial officials would have no choice but to accept the Fort Stanwix cession, avoid the hard labor treaty, and let Virginia have Kentucky. For their part, the Iroquois left the November 1768 Stanwix Congress with a promise of goods worth £10,000, the largest amount Britain had ever paid Indians for land. They also hoped that the Stanwix cession would divert the flow of European and African colonists from their own land. Many British colonists believed that the British government would not only ratify the Fort Stanwix cession, but also repeal the Proclamation of 1763. Stanwix thus set off a land rush. Veterans of the 7 Years' War, led by George Washington, asked the Executive Council for land bounties that the government had promised them after the war. Colonel Washington also began buying up his fellow veterans' bounty rights. He advised his brother Charles to approach veterans in a joking way, rather than in earnest at first, in order to see what value they seemed to set upon their lands. If Charles Washington could obtain the veterans' grants for £7 or less per 1,000 acres, he was directed to do so. Thomas Walker of Albemarle County, whose great-grandson considered him as great a landmonger as General Washington, reactivated the dormant Loyal Land Company. Between November 1768 and April 1769, he persuaded government surveyors to mark off hundreds of homesteads within the Loyal Company's ill-defined preliminary grant. In February 1769, Walker's neighbor Thomas Jefferson, whose late father had been a Loyal Company member, asked the company for 5,000 acres. Jefferson also joined two new syndicates, seeking land. His share in each was to be 1,000 acres. In joining two different land companies, something that few, if any, other Virginians did at this time, Jefferson hoped to evade an instruction adopted in 1754 by the Privy Council that prohibited any person from taking more than 1,000 acres of Indian land. Early in 1769, at the height of the land rush that followed the Stanwix Congress, the British government signaled its intention to keep its promise to leave Kentucky on the western side of the Anglo-Cherokee border. By April 1769, The Virginia Executive Council had no choice but to void the hundreds of surveys that had been done for Virginia speculators and to put a halt to further surveying. This setback only intensified the speculators' effort to persuade the government to let them have Kentucky and the adjacent region. The same Executive Council that reluctantly voided the Trans-Appalachian surveys declared at the same time that the hard labor boundary would be highly injurious to this colony and to the crown of Great Britain by giving to the Indians an extensive tract of land. In December, the House of Burgesses adopted the petition for Kentucky mentioned before. In the region west of the hard labor boundary, Virginia land speculators had received preliminary grants totaling 6 to 7 million acres. The disputed area also contained nearly 50,000 square miles of additional land that would be available to speculators to sell in the future. Virginia would, if the Privy Council honored the petition, nearly double its land area. 2. The fate of the Assembly's petition for Kentucky hinged upon the Privy Council's acceptance of its contention that, with the relinquishment by the Iroquois of their claim to Kentucky and the adjacent region, no tribe of Indians at present sets up any pretensions to the area. Actually, the nations that hunted in Kentucky denied the right of the Iroquois to sell it. The Shawnees acknowledged the Six Nations as our elder brethren, and as such, have listened to them while we found their advice good. Shawnee headman Red Hawk told British officials, "But their power extends no further with us." Alexander McKee, whose mother was Shawnee, was a British agent charged with monitoring the Upper Ohio Valley Indians. McKee wrote that the numbers of white people and surveyors that come out to the Ohio River in the spring of 1769 to settle and survey the country about Fort Pitt, Pittsburgh, and down the Ohio has set all their warriors in a rage. No Indian nation acting alone could do the British much damage. The natives' power depended upon their ability to unify across national borders. In June 1765, warriors from two of the nations that had participated in Pontiac's rebellion, the Maskoutens and Kickapoos, killed three diplomats representing a third, the Shawnees. The killing those three Shawnee deputies has entirely broke up the anti-British Confederacy, Indian agent George Cogren reported the following month. The attack placed the Shawnees and their Upper Ohio allies, the Delawares, in a virtual state of war with the Maskoutens, Kickapoos, and their allies on the Wabash River, the Miamis, Piankashaws, and Wees. In 1769, on the heels of the Stanwix land deal and in the midst of the ensuing Virginia land rush, the Wabash River and Upper Ohio Confederacies launched an effort to settle their differences. As a Shawnee headman later recalled, Wabash headmen metaphorically approached him and his colleagues with tears, asking pardon, acknowledging the fault they had committed against the Shawnees. The wives of their chiefs have likewise asked pardon of ours. Although the Wabash headmen's peace message apparently elicited no reply, when the head women's message arrived in Shawnee country, a male sachem later reported, "Our wives heard it with pleasure, and they passed it to the Delawares, where all the wives of chiefs received it in the same manner, and it was passed to all the different villages." Later, the Shawnees would make a large wampum belt and state that all the wives of as many tribes as there is, marks upon the belt received the Wabash Women's Peace Initiative with pleasure. Among the Upper Ohio nations, when a female village sachem, known as a peace woman, asked a male war sachem to break off a planned attack, she seldom failed to dissuade him. American Indian agent C.C. Trowbridge reported in 1824, "The headwomen on the Upper Ohio persuaded their male counterparts to listen to the speech of the wives of the Wabash, and to forget all the insults given them by these nations. a Shawnee headman later reported. This Shawnee speaker made a compelling appeal to the diverse Indian nations threatened by the cession of lands made to the English by the Six Nations. British General Thomas Gage learned, "Be always united," the Shawnee diplomat said. Heeding this advice, the Upper Ohio and Wabash nations revived the coalition that had rebelled against the British in 1760.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.